Actors are asked why they choose to play a certain role or star in a certain movie. They usually answer, the script moved me. Is this always the case, though?
One thing very frustrating is that if a film is successful, it's because the director is great. But if a film flops, it's because the writing is bad.
Parang hindi nila na-realize the amount of effort, time, and talent that we put into a script.
What makes a particular script great anyway? And what happens when things like economics and marketability get in the way?
For the longest time, the problem with writers has always been the talent fee of the writer. And you know, the guild cannot even help us get the minimum and the maximum talent fee.
Join me and my guests as we talk about the screenwriter's life here on CINEMATALK, where we have all the right stuff. The right stuff. That's awful. Who wrote this anyway? Good evening, I'm Nanette Medved and welcome to CINEMATALK. Tonight we talk about cinema, a world that loves an underdog. Yet within its own ranks lay several underdogs that go largely unnoticed. The unsung heroes behind our favorite films, the scriptwriter. Controversy has plagued this part of the industry for as long as we can remember. Is the saying starving screenwriters true? Let's find out. Joining us tonight are two highly acclaimed and very popular screenwriters. First, we have the fastest pen in the industry. We have director-writer Joey Javier Reyes, or Joey Reyes, who started writing for television in 1977 and is now one of the most awarded writer-directors in the country.
That sounds so flattering.
Well, it's true. It's your second time on our show, Deba.
Yes, I was here for your pilot, so I'm very flattered.
Thank you. Okay, we're flattered you came by. Mm-hmm. Next, we have Miss Raquel Villavicencio, who started writing award-winning movies in the early 80s. But before we get into the meat of our discussion, let's take a look at what it's really like to be a screenwriter in the Philippines. Please watch this.
A lot of people think that being a screenwriter is an easy job. You just sit in front of a computer and develop a complete script. No way, it's not that easy. It takes more than just knowing how to type to become a credible screenwriter.
Pag nag-uumpisa ka sa pagsusulat, syempre, hindi pa sila masyadong magtitiwala sa iyo as a writer because you've never, kumbaga, when I was starting, even for television, you have not written a script yet. So parang kailangan magpakita ng gilas ka muna sa kanila. Kailangan patunayan mo muna sa kanila na kaya mo yung ginagawa mo bilang isang scriptwriter. Kailangan patunayan mo sa kanila na may talento ka doon. At doon ka, kahit pagkaganda mo na yung script mo, medyo hahanapan pa nila ng mga rough edges. Minsan yung mga butas nilang nakikita o nakita, eh talagang hindi naman tam, hindi na talaga butas. Naghahanap na lang ng butas. They were nitpicking on my script. Whereas, if a writer is already so well-established, kahit pa siguro anong ibigay nila, tatanggapin na, lulunutin na, ito talamang galing ito kay so-and-so, so automatically dapat maganda na yun.
If you want to become a screenwriter, you can take several routes. There are workshops being held annually by award-winning scriptwriter Ricky Lee and by other groups like the Cultural Center of the Philippines and ABS-CBN. Or you can go to a formal school which offers writing classes.
Industriya natin ngayon kasi is in a very sorry state dahil sa dami ng problema. So bagsak na bagsak ang industriya. Kukunti ang assignments ngayon, kukunti ang pelikula ang ginagawa natin every year. Nagko-cost cutting sa lahat ng areas. And despite yung mga sinabi ko na nakakalungkot, I would still encourage people who want to write, to go ahead. Samahan nyo kami magsulat.
Okay, we're back. I'm going to ask you first. Obviously, you're not starving writers, but how is it that you two started? Direct Joey, how did you start?
Long story. I started out writing professionally for dinner theater.
Dinner theater?
Yes.
Is there still such a thing?
Oh boy, in the 70s there was. It was pretty popular during the 70s. It was with boys in the band in Taglish. You were a little girl at that time. Okay. And from then on, somebody saw me from BBC Channel 2. That was when Channel 2 was still up there in Broadcast City.
Okay.
And asked me to write a television show, a sitcom. Okay, and so I started out writing sitcoms and drama anthologies. That was sometime around 1977, 1978. But as far as screenwriting is concerned, when I started out screenwriting, that was when I was scrambling for a job. I mean, the head of creative creatures here in ABS-CBN, Edmund T., used to peddle my scripts. I used to write speculative scripts.
Okay.
This was the time of Bancom and Agrix Bayona, no?
Agrix
Films. And I used to write speculative scripts, and he would peddle it around, showing it to producers.
Okay.
And you know, it took quite some time before my reputation as a screenwriter came into completion. It was after Oro Plata Mata with Peke Galiaga that I was finally, you know, relatively recognized.
Okay, and how about Raquel? How did you start?
I started writing, co-writing with Doy Del Mundo and Mike De Leon on three projects, which the first was Kakabakaba, Batch 81,
That's
and
right.
Kisap Mata.
But how did you land that job?
It was quite by accident that I got to enter showbiz because...
Raquel is the ultimate late bloomer, eh?
Why?
I think in Koya, a lot of people have told me that. It was when I was already a housewife that I saw an ad in the paper saying that there was a film workshop at the LVN studios.
How old are you at this point?
I was 26.
Wow.
At that time, no?
Okay.
And I said, you know, I was kind of bored just being at home with my babies. And I said, I wanted to do something that I really, really, really wanted to do for a change instead of, you know, trying all these things na para lang may magawa. This time I said, parang I really want to do this. So I went to attend this workshop for a whole month, and I met all these people who were already, at that time, names in the industry, like Mike De Leon, Lino Broca, Ishmael Bernal, Loris Guillen, now Pio De Castro, Mel Chonglo.
How privileged to be in a workshop
at
with
the
these
time, it was
types of people.
It was a
this caliber.
And it's the one and only workshop that was organized that way, no? Up to now, wala pa rin
something similar.
Naulit na ganon. So talagang privilege yung batch namin. And from that batch, I think about just three of us actually entered the movies. The rest,
went
I don't know what happened to them,
Really?
But from there, siguro Mike realized that I had, you know, some writing skills, so...
Boy, I'll say.
At the time, some pa lang, no? Because I never even imagined that I would get into the industry writing for the movies. Parang, you know, I could do production design and all that. But to actually be a screenwriter was something I never dreamed of. Parang short stories lang, ganun, no? And so when Mike asked me to co-write with him the movie Kakabakabakaba, syempre, parang nakakatakot because he was Mike De Leon and Doy Del Mundo had done a lot of scripts already for him. They had worked together before. Sabi ko, sige, ha? Sorry na lang, amateur pa ako. You have to teach me. And it was really Doy who really taught me a lot of things about writing. I'm lucky that way.
Back when you two were in the struggling writer phase, what were your frustrations?
Oh, a lot.
A lot? Like what? Are they the same frustrations that writers experience today, or is
very,
it
very much
different?
So. Very much
like
so.
Like what?
Firstly, is because, you really have to erase all of your ego if you should so choose to be a screenwriter.
Why?
Mainly because film is a director's medium. Okay, film is a director's medium. In other words, you just give the recipe to the director, and the director would have to cook it up in whichever way he so chooses to do. One thing very frustrating is that if a film is successful, it's because the director is great. But if a film flops, it's because the writing is bad. And when you're a screenwriter, you prepare yourself. Now your script will really be mangled, discombobulated, you know, made himay. And
that happened to you?
Oh, a lot of times.
Sometimes
so you gave them a script and hindi na recognizable by the time you've seen
it? Oh, yes.
Really?
Yeah. You know, sometimes, oh, my God.
Why do you want to take your name out of the credits because it's not yours anymore.
Really? And you have no, writers have no control over the end product?
The moment you give in the script, to the producer or to the director, you lose control of it.
Actually, I wanted to ask you, but are there other frustrations other than that?
Oh, definitely. When you're starting,
like what?
Stolen stories.
Stolen stories. Okay. Stolen stories. What else?
Well, stolen
the financial
stories. Yeah, the financial.
Like what? How much? How much did you earn for like dinner theater?
Oh, that was pittance. But during that time, it was a lot. Now, remember, I was a professor. How much do you earn teaching? No?
Okay, oh, that's true.
How much do you earn teaching? So, yung extra 200 pesos a week is nirvana.
200 pesos a week?
Yeah, but in 1977, you know, 200 pesos went a long way, right? Hindi pan-taxi lang yung 200.
Oh my gosh. So, financially, it's also frustrating.
Oh, yeah. We were starving at that time, no, honestly.
But, diba, Raquel, even up to now, the ratio of payment that a screenwriter gets...
still not commensurate.
How much do screenwriters, like, not you guys, obviously, you're at that upper tier already, but how much do, like, does a regular writer earn nowadays?
Oh, dear. You'd be surprised. I hate to quote prices.
Like,
no, but
do
then,
they sell it per script?
Yeah.
Per script. Okay.
I know that even to this day and age, hindi ba, at a 52 is to 1 peso dollar exchange rate, there's scripts still being sold at 30,000.
Yeah, but you know,
30,000 pesos.
The reason that this happens is because some writers, in order to just, you know, break into the industry, ganun ka desperado. Talagang tatanggap na lang sila ng kahit magkano.
What's the minimum and the maximum?
No, it should be at this point about 80,000 minimum.
Per script.
Minimum. Per script for a first timer and a maximum of God knows, you know, how much.
Okay.
I know of a screenwriter who supposedly or allegedly got a million for her script.
So 80 to a million for a script.
Hindi ko yun. Oh, yeah.
Okay, so, but if it's not the two of you, kokonti na lang yan. There are only a few of you in that bracket.
Somebody did, no?
Okay.
But then, it's not a question of the pay that you get, hindi ba? It's not even a question of the payment that you get. It's a question of protecting your rights as a writer.
Okay.
And now, most especially now, Nanette, with the condition of the Philippine movie industry, aba, magyabang ka and you demand, you know, 500,000 for your script, it will be a half a million in your dreams. Nobody will get you.
Yeah. That's true. Uh-huh. And they can always take the idea and run with it, as you said.
Correct. Yes. Okay.
Here you said, let's say, 80 to a million pesos for a script. Here it's called buyout, diba? Mm-hmm. You basically, you know, you surrender all rights when you sell the script to them. So in other words, you have no participation, let's say, if the script becomes a blockbuster.
Nope.
If it becomes a Titanic.
No royalties.
Oo.
None.
The taba ng puso mo na lang ang inuwi mo.
There used to be a time when producers would give a little bonus to the writers.
God, so long ago.
Nakalimutan na namin yun.
So discretion ng producer.
Ngayon wala na.
Wala na.
Wala na.
We don't have rights for, you know, TV sales, for cable sales, or even for franchise. Yeah, wala.
They were saying sa States, writers get 1.2% of gross revenue after a certain threshold. Mm-hmm. So, sabihin natin lumagpas ng 10 million, you get automatically in perpetua.
That's why naman, if you look at the houses in Architectural Digest of screenwriters in Hollywood, hindi ba? They look better than the houses of the directors in the Philippines, hindi ba?
That's true.
But we don't have that here, mainly because...
Why?
Well, firstly, our industry is not as large as Hollywood, which markets its products all over the world.
Right.
Sa atin is very limited, and it's becoming even more limited right now.
Not talking about an absolute amount. You're talking about a percentage of a smaller pie as well.
Mm. Well, that smaller pie will never be shared, you know, by...
Why?
Why, Raquel?
Sino bang tatanungin natin?
No, I guess it's yung limitasyon ng producers ngayon.
I've always had this theory about, you know, a writer's work, a writer's work or contribution to a project, no? Parang hindi nila nare-realize the amount of effort, time, and talent that we put into a script. Kasi kami, we work at home, you know, where nobody sees us and they don't even know we're working pala.
Mm-mm. Yeah.
Unlike a director who's on the set every day, a cameraman, even the gaffer or, you know, the utusan, they see them on the set, nagtatrabaho sige. Pero nasan yung writer? Wala eh.
So in other words, in a director, when you can say 30 shooting days and you can calculate some sort of amount that you feel is appropriate. In the writer's case, it may take him 30 hours or 30 years to make a script and it makes
and
no difference.
And he just lives on the power of his reputation and his reputation is based on the sellability or the box office receipts of his last movie.
Okay, we're going to talk about that some more when we come back. So please don't go away. CINEMATALK returns.
Screenwriters are among the most important movie artists, and yet they often end up holding the short end of the stick. Yes, aside from coming up with brilliant ideas for a film, there are other challenges that they still have to face.
Actually, yung pinakamalaking problema ng scriptwriter sa Pilipinas, and maski sa ibang bansa, pero lalo na dito sa atin sa Pilipinas, hindi talaga nare-recognize ang scriptwriter. Hindi siya binibigyan ng enough na respeto, enough na recognition na nadideserve niya. And so, ang fight ng scriptwriter ay fight pa na pinaka-basic, which is, kilalanin niyo kami. Kilalanin niyo yung worth ng aming contribution sa paggawa ng pelikula. Kung may hagdan, may scale ng payment sa mga gumagawa ng pelikula, at kung nandito ang director, nung nagsimula akong gumawa ng pelikula, nung Dragnet at nung Jaguar, ito ang director, number two ang writer. Ngayon na, sa mas mababa ng writer. May ibang mga number two na, may cinematographer, etc. Bumaba na sa hagdan yung writer. Lumalapit na siya sa assistant director. So, tumaas man ang bayad sa writer through these years, hindi kasing taas ng itinaas ng iba pang gumagawa ng pelikula. Any time na nakikita kita mga writers, lagi na lang lumalabas yung mga hinaing, mga complaints, mga gripes, mga script nilang inagaw o nasulot o nanakaw o hindi nabayaran, mga premiere nights na pinalabas na hindi naimbita yung writer, mga credits sa TV man o sa pelikula nakalimutan yung pangalan ng writer. Yun, lagi ang lumalabas hanggang ngayon.
A lot of Filipino screenwriters have tried to solve this problem by coming up with a protective organization, the Screenwriters Guild of the Philippines, which aims to watch over the rights of the screenwriter.
So isa sa pinakauna namin ginawa nung nag-assume kami ng leadership sa scripting ngayon, inamend namin yung constitution para pwede nang pumasok at maging miyembro ang mga TV writers. So we'll be having workshops sa SGP para nakikita na ang writer patuloy na nagtutrain ng sarili, patuloy na nagpapakabuti sa kanyang craft. And then eventually, we will talk with directors and producers para we will have better working relationships with them para mas nagtutulungan.
Okay, we're back. Before we finish what we were talking about earlier, are you members actually of the, what is it? It's called Screenwriters Guild of the
mm-hmm.
Philippines?
Screenwriters Guild of the
are
Philippines.
Are you both members?
Nagbayad ka na ba ng juice?
Ako ay...
In good standing ba tayo?
I don't think I'm in good standing. I don't think
why?
I am.
We have, if you don't pay your juice kasi...
They, you're not anymore in good standing.
They were saying in the U.S. Guild mm-hmm. that they actually... When they fight for the rights of a writer, they fight for the rights of members and non-members because their feeling is the benefits of fighting for the industry as a whole kind of uplifts exactly. Yeah. And they were saying, then what happens is, ang labanan is no longer the cheapest writer you can get, but the best because the rates are relatively
that's
the
right.
same.
That's right.
And nobody's doing that here.
No, nobody's doing that here because the other prerogative right now is, I think, what is more important right now is to get jobs for the writers rather than to price the writers.
Is it hard now for a script writer to find a job?
Oh, yes.
Somebody's got to write the work. Who's writing it?
Yeah, but there's not that many movies kasi being produced right now. So the industry...
is really shaking. The drop from the year 1999 to the year 2001 is very marked.
But there's a lot of local programming that's going on on TV.
On TV.
Yeah. But again, that's a different ball game altogether, and I don't know if it is proper for me to discuss the situation of television writers within the network setup, because you have also little fiefdoms and kingdoms as far as
within the
you
networks.
These are the writers of station. These are the writers of Y
there's
station.
A pool.
There's a pool
under contract, which never existed before during our time.
Let's say, for example, movie company A buys your script and you love this script and 10 years later it hasn't been made or 5 years later it hasn't been made. Do you have the right to reacquire the script?
In my case, each time I offer a spec script, in other words, a non-commissioned script by a specific studio, I give it a certain time frame. Okay, so I say, okay, this is a spec script. Are you interested in this? Okay, and they put an option. Actually, it's not full payment naman. It's a down payment. Which means they have the first option for
right
that script.
Right of refusal. Okay.
The right of refusal. So I'll give it about 3 years. If after 3 years you have not produced this, it's mine again.
What happens if they take the idea and produce a movie based on the idea of your spec script?
I'm going to sue them.
Really? And does anything ever come of those lawsuits, or you just hassle them?
Well, I have not yet had the opportunity of suing anybody, but I will sue them.
Really?
Because it will certainly set a precedent.
That's
which, less, how shall I put it, influential writers would be victimized.
What are your favorite scripts?
That I wrote or she wrote?
Both of you.
That Joey wrote.
Joey, what's the favorite? What is your most...
It is a hard question,
yeah,
always.
Yeah, it is. Okay.
Really, why?
Yeah, because every time naman you write something, it's like a baby where you pour everything into the care of that script. Eh. So you can't say, I like this one better than that. Because everything comes from the heart of the writer. And
which one? Which one do you identify with most then?
Answer that, woman.
Ayoko, baka ma-compromise ako. Ikaw na lang.
No, my favorite script of hers is okay. Relacion.
Relacion.
Yeah.
Oh,
which I didn't even write.
Oh, you didn't write?
You didn't write Relacion?
I mean, well, yeah, I did write part of it.
So, teenage marriage.
Teenage marriage.
Yeah, those are the things. Mga marriage movies niya, the ones I love the best.
Why? You wouldn't? Why? Are you so emotionally involved in the scripts that you can't?
Tell me about it.
Really?
I know her when she goes through that process. Yeah.
Really?
Oh, ganun, kailangan ganun eh. Otherwise, you'll come up with a half-baked or, you know.
Yeah.
Such that you can't really even identify a script that you... That is really...
I would say that I like them all.
Okay, how about you, Joey? You're the one closest to your heart.
There are about three which are really close to my heart.
Okay.
Okay, the first is Bakit Labis Kitang Mahal? Okay, that's with Aga, Lea, and Ariel.
Okay. Yeah.
Because it's closest to my heart in writing because it's a story that I wanted to write before and I finally had the chance to write it and it was a hit.
Okay.
The second one is Batang PX. The one I did first, that's with Patrick Garcia and Shasha Padilla. Mm-hmm. Because I've always wanted to write a story about Amerations or the people, you know, an American.
This is the one that Shasha won for, diba?
Yes, okay. Yes. Mm. And the last, of course, is Live Show or Toro.
Mm.
Because, the controversial.
The controversial one.
Because even when I was writing it, I knew I was doing something different. It's something you do not expect someone like me based on the, you know, the body of works that I have done.
Yeah.
Diba?
Mm-hmm.
I really love that, mainly because it really spoke of the human condition of Filipinos. And I hindi ako nagpapa-relevant or anything. Mm-hmm. And I really empathize with Raquel. When you're writing a script, Nanette, you know, you're locked up. And I was crying half the time because you're living through the experience.
Really?
Yeah.
You have to get into the character kasi, to be able to get into the truth. Mm-mm. Of that character.
So you actually live the process while you write the script?
I cry.
So how
on
traumatic
my
when you decide to write a script?
That's
write
why.
A script.
That's, you know, that's why.
Huh?
It is really blood, sweat, and tears.
Really?
When you write.
And people say, you made mention that I'm the fastest pen in this side of the planet. It's because you just have to purge yourself because it's absolute torture. When you're going through a script, especially when you're doing a really, really, really heavy drama script.
Where do you get your inspiration for a story?
Real life, talaga.
Real
it's
life.
Friend stories who come to you with all kinds of heartbreaking
okay,
stories.
Of course, she has to rub my shoulder. Right?
Give away.
Yeah. Uh-uh.
Really?
We would talk to each other until 5 in the morning.
Yeah.
Kami ni Joey dati.
So you base it on real life
real
situations
life,
that come
family,
your way.
My family, my children.
Uh-huh. Really?
Yeah.
Does that bother like the people around you? Because I come to and pour my heart out next month. I'm seeing it on TV.
No, but precisely these people, when they know you're a writer, uh-oh, they come up to you and they say, "Uy, alam mo, ganda-ganda ng
story."
Okay.
Ganyan sila.
Everybody wants their
so flattered if you use them in a movie.
Really?
I use my friends' names. I use my children's friends' names.
Really?
Enjoy sila.
That's why I love having my emotional traumas kasi napapakitaan ko yun. You have a major heartbreak.
That's a new way to look at it.
Nakabili akong bagong kotse dahil din sa heartbreak na to. Di ba?
Really?
So,
if that's the case, marami akong material para sa inyo. We'll share. No, but you, Joey, where do you get your inspiration? Also,
real life
situation. Real life.
I have my eyes and ears open all the time. Okay. And at the same time, I read a lot. Okay, I really read a lot.
Reading.
And basically from my own personal experiences. Because hindi ba in every stage naman in your life, your priorities change, namumulat ang mata mo sa iba't ibang bagay.
Mm-mm.
That's what you capture. And as I said, every trauma I get, oh God.
Yeah,
you know,
this is good material.
Yeah, you know, my last heartbreak, naka-12 scripts yun.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
So I have to thank that creature who broke my heart. You know, thanks.
Napakinabangan din. Are you conscious of the box office ability of a script?
We have to be. It is a given, syempre.
Do you sacrifice your art for commercial success?
No, kasi rin naman, I mean, movies, filmmaking is such a freaky process, no? It's unlike painting or sculpture or even writing a novel, no? Mm. I mean, movies per se is commercial.
Okay.
Most especially in this country where you don't have independent producers anymore. That's why you have to take into consideration the commercial viability. And even in my part, which I also line produce, I look at it in terms of how are they going to market this material.
But you wear many hats. Maybe that's the benefit. That's why you're Joey Reyes, is you've worn so many hats.
I'm just a busybody. But she also wears many hats. She was a production designer.
That's right. Yeah.
She became a scriptwriter, and now she's an femme fatale actress, di ba?
That kind of started naman ano eh.
Well, you, God knows you've had enough practice with your crying in your room, di ba, to do drama. Okay, we're going to go to a break, but we'll be back for our, I'm always saying this, our closing remarks when we come back, so please don't go away. We wanted to ask you, if for all of the aspiring writers out there, mga wannabe and aspiring screenwriters, what advice would you give them, considering the times are so bad?
Who starts?
Either of you.
Kelly.
Ako, all I can say is, no matter what, they should just keep on writing. Because writing, hindi naman mawawala sa mundo ang writing. Eh. And there will always be people who will need writers. So, it might not be your time now. Your time will come. But just continue to do what you love to do best. It's writing.
Even if they're not terribly successful at it?
It will come.
Really? As coming from someone who was a late bloomer. And you, Director Wei.
I give him the same advice, you know, just to keep on writing. A lot of people ask me, how do you write? But I said, I write by writing. Yeah, you know, I mean, how do you write a screenplay? You just go ahead, learn the basics, and then go for it. Siguro mas may dadagdag ko pang advice is that I think Philippine cinema does not need another Joey Reyes. It does not need another Raquel Villavicencio. It does not need another Ricky Lee. It doesn't need another Lualati Bautista. It needs somebody new. Never be stifled by anybody to conform to a certain style. You develop your style because it is because of your style in writing that you become who you are as a writer. Although you may be working in a very commercial constraint with so many compromises and demands, be who you are and fight for the kind of writing that you want. And that's the only time that you will be successful. God knows that there are so many established writers who've had their time and are still having their time. That's not what cinema needs right now. They need somebody new. And originality is style. Be original.
That's very nice. Okay, and my last question. If there was one person out there or a group of people that could actually help the screenwriting industry, what would you want them to do for you guys as screenwriters to help? Raquel first.
Number one, I think it's to subsidize the industry.
In what way?
Pera. pera talaga ang kailangan.
From the government?
Government.
Government subsidy for writing.
Yes, because there are several countries in the world where the government subsidizes their industries and they're very successful. Tayo kasi very privatized ang industry. Eh. So, you know, there's a lot of small producers out there. And the reason why the industry doesn't seem to be going where it should go is because it's not very united at this point. So somebody has to come in.
So you think
help.
A subsidy will help that? Yeah. And you, Director?
I mean, more than a subsidy, I guess, it's recognition by the government that we are an industry. Mm-hmm. We are being treated like, you know, the clowns next door who are just here to give fantasies, entertainers. Mm-hmm. Australia has succeeded in a span of just a little bit over 10 years from lifting a relatively unknown industry into the one of the major film forces all over the world. At this point, even Thailand is already superseding us.
In more aspects than one.
Because when the crisis of 1997 took place, the Thais reacted by a sincere sense of nationalism, by patronizing their own films. The only way for the industry to really pick up itself is for the government to help us. And by help, we don't mean lip service, but real honest-to-goodness help in professionalizing the industry.
And you think it should come from the government?
Definitely. So after all, ilan na ba mga nasa industry ang pumasok sa gobyerno? Diba?
Okay.
Dapat lang naman tulungan nila tayo.
Diba? Okay, I think we should end there. It's going to get more controversial. Huwag na lang. Okay. Thank you very much for being with us tonight. And of course, before we go, we would like to thank our sponsors, Play and Display, for our set, Mix for our outfit, and of course, you for watching. The stories that they write are fascinating. But their own stories are just as fascinating, and if not, more interesting. Being a screenwriter takes more than just a computer or a typewriter. This we have learned from our silent heroes, that they are truly brilliant minds that also need protection and respect from our local industry. This has been Nanette Medved, and this is CINEMATALK. Good night, and see you
again. My favorite script of hers is Relacion.
Relacion.
Yeah.
Which I didn't even write.
Oh, you didn't write?
You didn't write Relacion?
I mean, well, yeah, I did write part of it.
Yeah, and another one's Broken Marriage. That's yours.
No,
right? Yeah. Direct?
Well,
and I thought I knew you, so Teenage Marriage.
Teenage Marriage.
Yeah, those are the things. Teenage marriage movies, the ones I loved the best.
Why? You, how about the most fun script for you?
The most... Galaw-gaw, which is a little, you know, known movie of Ishmael Bernal. It was
with
a comedy.
No, it's the second Galaw-gaw.
Yeah, it's not
second
really Galaw-gaw. A remake. It's just, okay. You know, Maricel.
Oh my God, that's right. Hello, yeah, you probably Maricel wasn't Soriano, born then.
William Martinez.
Uh-oh. Why? What made it so fun?
Number one, I didn't write it also.
Ano ba yan?
Why?
Ishmael wrote Galaw-gaw. Okay. I did the production design.
Ah, you did the PD.
Okay. Yeah, I did the PD.
Ah, okay.
No, kakabakaba was a lot of fun. Now, you hope that, okay?
Kakabakaba was a lot of fun.